See. Groups had a couple of songs for us.
Red, white, and blue.
Thank you. Oh, thank you.
When there's no one else to turn to, who do I talk to? When no one wants to listen, who do I lean on? When there's no foundation stable, I go to the rock. I know that he's able, I go to the rock. I go to the rock of my salvation, go to the stone that the builder rejected. Run to the mountain and the mountain stands by me. The earth all around me is sinking sand. On Christ the solid rock I stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, I go to the rock. Where do I hear it? Till the storms have all passed over, where do I run to? When the winds of sorrow threaten, is there a refuge? In the time of tribulation, when my soul needs consolation, I go to the rock. I go to the rock of my salvation, go to the stone that the builders rejected. Run to the mountain and the mountain stands by me. The earth all around me is sinking sand. On Christ the solid rock I stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, I go to the rock. I go to the rock of my salvation, go to the stone that the builder rejected. Run to the mountain and the mountain stands by me. The earth all around me is sinking sand. On Christ the solid rock I stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, the rock, rock of ages. I go to 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 the rock.
Okay, we can't find our words.
I'm gonna add them.
What happened to that little thing we had?
I didn't make it.
Okay, they're really small, so we're good.
To my knees will I fall, will I sing hallelujah, will I be able to speak it all, I can only imagine, I can only imagine, I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun, I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only pouring all of you be still. imagine when all I will do is forever worship you.
Well, good morning to you. We're going to start our two-part series on the church and what is it, and what does the church do? And my goal behind all this, I'm just going to go ahead and lay it out there so you know, some of you, I'm coming after you, is that I want to spell out to you how essential the church is. Yes, I'm sorry for Children's Church. I always forget that. I'm sorry. But what I want to do for the next couple of weeks is to spell out how essential the church is and how that you need the church. Now, I have to help me illustrate what a church is. I have a slideshow and I want your participation. So I want you to scream out the answers if you know them. All right. Now, what do you call a group of lions? Does anybody know? Just yell it out. Pride. Right? Boom. Y'all got that one right. All right. What do you call a group of tigers? Trouble. You call it an ambush. You would, wouldn't you? That snuck up on me. All right. What do you call? Y'all know this one. What do you call a group of wolves?
A pack.
Pack. All right. Very good. All right, this one's got, the next two are kind of difficult. So, what do you call a group of crows? Got it. It's a murder. All right, this one's a good one. What do you call a group of cockroaches? Gross. You just call it gross, right? Now you know what it is. It's a intrusion. So there you go. Now. With that in mind, okay, everything that is a group is known by a name, right? So loosely termed, loosely defined, what do you call a group of Christians who are come together? You call it the church. Now, that's loosely defined, I know. The church, in your notes, I have it for you, the church is not a building. I know we say, hey, I'm going to church this morning. But that's not really, the church is not a building. The church is the people that reside inside the building. This is where we have decided to assemble together. And that's why we call it the building. We call it the church because that's where the church meets. But the church is not a building. You know, there's a lot of people that criticize the church. And this is one of the reasons you hear more than any other reason why people don't join the church, is they'll say, well, there's all these hypocrites out here. And now I want to look at them, so what are you doing here? The church is a body. The church is a body of sinners. It's a society of sinners who have realized it and have banded themselves together to do something about it. The church is the only place I know of that you can profess to, that in order to join, you have to profess to be bad. The only other groups that are an exception to that are gangs and Hell's Angels. But you have to profess to be bad, don't you? You have to admit you're a sinner, right? Everyone in here is a sinner. And so, yes, is the church full of hypocrites? Absolutely. But you know what? Walmart was full of hypocrites. It didn't stop you from going to Walmart, did it? And there's a far better reason for you to be here in the church than to get some produce and some merchandise, isn't there? And so why would that hinder you from being in the church? Now, it's been long said that if you find a perfect church, don't join it. Why? Because you'll ruin it.
Amen. All right. Now, here's the thing. And understand this. There are a lot of people who go about criticizing the church and what she is and what she's doing. But did you know that the scriptures lay out that the church is the bride of Christ? Now, you can say all you want about me, but you start criticizing my wife, you got another thing coming. Okay? You can say all you want about me, but you start bringing my wife into the mix, and that's fighting words now. Now, don't you think Christ would feel the same way about his church? It's his church. It's his bride. He will do, and he will discipline and handle it the way he sees fit, but I'd beware if I thought it was my place to criticize the bride of Christ. Now, here's the question I want to pose to you. Does a lion being born a lion, you know, just like we looked up there, a lion, just because he's born a lion, does that make him automatically part of a pride? No. It doesn't, does it? And can I say this? As someone who's a born-again Christian, does that by default make them a part of a church? And the answer is no. And I'm going to show you how the scriptures lay that out. Otherwise, if it was to be true that if you were a church or you were considered part of the church the moment you were saved, then you could be a church unto yourself. And all the people who were hunters said, amen. Because then I can go praise Jesus on my deer stand, right? And I'm doing church there, right? But we know that that's not the case. That's not the truth. The church, by definition, I want you to write this part down. This is something you need to have memorized. The church, by definition, it is a local, visible, called out assembly of baptized believers who have coveted themselves together to carry out the Great Commission. That is what a church is. And where do you see that? Where do you see what? It's where you see the church beginning. You see the definition where the church began. And if you want to write this in your margin, I invite you to do so. Matthew chapter 4, verse 19. You see, this is where the church began. And how do you say that? Because look at the definition and look what happens here with Jesus. And he said unto them, who are them? The disciples. Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. That is what a church is, isn't it? We're following after Christ, and we have been called out of this world, right? We've been called out of our sin, and we have joined together to carry out the Great Commission. And that's what you see right here. Jesus is calling his disciples out from the world, and they forsook their nets, didn't they? And they followed him. And he says, if you follow me, I'm going to make you fishers of men. And as he adds to his church, you know what he's going to do with his church? He's going to make us all fishers of men, carrying out the Great Commission. This is what you see the church is. Now, that's why you can understand that this cannot happen on an individual basis. This is where it has to be a collective effort. Amen? This is where it has to be collective. So why is it so important? Why is it so imperative that you join and be part of a church? I want you to turn with me to 1 Corinthians and chapter 12. This is where we're going to look at why it's so important that you join and be a part of the church. If you missed the definition of the church earlier, it's up there now. I'm sorry, I left it off there for you. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I want you to hear what this chapter is saying. I'm going to give it to you in basically three phrases. One God, many gifts, one body. One God, many gifts, but one body. Now I want you to say it with me. One God, many gifts, one body. All right, let's look at this together. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 4. These are the things that you need to know about the churches. It's one God, many gifts, one body. Let's look at the part where it talks about one God. Verse 4, it says, now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. For to one is given the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another the gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the workings of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of gifts, to another diverse kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will, for as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. You see all that being laid out? One God, many gifts, but one body. One God, many gifts, but one body. Verse 13, for by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. Whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, we have been all made to drink into one Spirit. The selfsame God who called me into the ministry is the same God who has bestowed upon you at the moment of salvation gifts. Now, you say, well, what's the difference between a talent and a gift, right? Some of you are talented at certain things. A talent is something that you're born with, physically born with. A gift is something that is supernaturally given to you at the moment of salvation. When the Holy Spirit took up residence, He gave you spiritual gifts. And gifts are meant to be expressed in the church. Did you know that? The whole idea of one God, many gifts, but one body is an expression that's supposed to be taking place within the church. And the picture that's being portrayed here is that you have many members. You have many members. You have 10 fingers, right? You have 10 toes, most of you. You have 2 arms, right? You have 2 legs. You have these members. But did you know each one has a different function, doesn't it? I don't know about you, but if I was only a nose, and every time it itched, I'd be glad I had a hand. Because I got to scratch it. Now every one of y'all are going to start scratching your nose because you think it's going to itch. But do you understand? It has many functions, doesn't it? But it's part of one body. And just like your body has many parts, but different functions, so also the church has many members, doesn't it? Many of y'all are here, members. And many of y'all have been gifted, but with different things. And when you come together, you function like a body, don't you? Some of you are gifted at giving. That is your spiritual gift. Now, how would the church operate without that, right? Some of you are gifted in teaching, and some of you are great Sunday school teachers, and how would the church operate without that, right? You see how everyone has a function, and with that function, it's a necessity. They're all important, right? Like every part of your body is important, right? If you don't think a part of your body is important, meet me after church and we'll cut it off. It's like, I don't need that. I don't need this hand. Yeah, you do. You don't believe me, let me cut it off for you. It's like, man, my nose sure does itch now. Yeah, you bet you wish you had that hand now, don't you? You see how this all works? It all works together. And so just like, okay, you will never say, I don't need this part of my body anymore. I just don't need it. You will never say that, and so is the same. Every one of you who are here that is a member, you will never hear me say, and Lord willing, you'll never hear anyone else say, we don't need you. Why? Because you are essential to the body. You are essential to the body. You are important. You have a function in the body of Christ. And God has put this body together, and it bears many functions. And it's a glorious thing. But we see that there's one God, right? Now I want to look at the part where it talks about many gifts. Verse 14, it says, for the body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, because I'm not the hand, I am not the body, it is therefore not of the body. Is it therefore not of the body? I'm sorry. And if the ear shall say, because I am not the eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing? If the whole were a hearing, where would be the smelling? But now has God set the members, every one of them, in the body as it has pleased him. And if they were all one member, where would the body? Where were the body? You know, this kind of flies in the face, doesn't it? Of those who think they don't need the church. Praise God for my deer stand. Amen. Praise God for my sofa. I can listen to preaching on TV. Well, I always like to ask, well, who takes up the offering? Doesn't happen, does it? You need the church. I need the church. Because you know why? You represent a piece of the body. And if you are not present, that function is left off. Bet you wish you had that hand now that your nose itches, don't you? We need each other, don't we? That's what the body of Christ is. It has the functions. And if you don't attend, if you don't become a part of, then you rob the church of the gifts that God has given you. You rob the church. You have been gifted with certain gifts. And if you are not here to give those express gifts to the church, you rob us. You need the church because hear the woe that Ecclesiastes chapter 4 spells out. You know this chapter and this verse. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 9 and 10. You need the church because it says two are better than one. Because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, the one will lift up his fellow, but woe to him that is alone when he falls. For he hath not another to help him up. Did you know that you will not reach your full spiritual potential if you are not a part of a church? Why? Because think about it. Have you ever seen someone who always took something but never gave something out? Think about this. Think about a body of water. If it had only an inlet but had no outlet, what would happen? Well, you have the Dead Sea. It has inlets but no outlet. Water flows in, but it has no outlet. And you know what? It's dead. And spiritually, you will wither up and die within yourself because you have not an outlet for the gift that God has given you. You will not reach your spiritual potential without the church. These gifts are meant to be complementary. They work together. Because of that, they take care of one another. Knowing that without that part of the body, the whole body suffers loss. Isn't that right? If you didn't have your hand today, you wouldn't be able to hold your Bible now, would you? And that's what it's like, isn't it? If you were to envision people being actual body parts and think, we can't function as a church without that, without them, that takes on a different role, doesn't it? We start caring and loving because we need those people to be a part of the church. Because we need to minister to them. And contrast that, they need to minister to us. The body suffers loss when we don't come together. The third thing is that it's one body, right? One God, many gifts, but one body. Look, verse 20 says, but now are they many members, what does it say? But one body. And the eye cannot say unto the hand, I have no need of thee. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. Nay, much more those members of the body which seem to be more feeble are necessary. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, upon these we bestow more abundant honor. And our uncomely parts have more abundant comeliness. For our comely parts have no need. But God has tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacked. That there should be no schism, that is no division in the body. But that the members should have the same care one for another. And whether one member suffer, all the members suffer with it. Or one member is honored, All the members rejoiced with it. Now you are the body of Christ and members in particular. If you aren't a part of the body, then you have no outlet for your spiritual gifts that God has given you. This is also, I want you to understand, 1 Corinthians 12, it precedes 1 Corinthians 13. What's 1 Corinthians 13? It's the love chapter, right? It's the love chapter. That's the whole context of this, is you have these spiritual gifts. Now, how should you express them? Well, I could... Because God has called me into the ministry, He's given me the gift of prophecy. And imagine if I were to take the pulpit this way. Well, God gave me the gift of prophecy, so I better get up here and tell Him something. And I, you know, and have no care for you. I just got to get up here and say, "Thus saith the Lord." That's wrong, isn't it? Contrast that. Let's say your spiritual gift is giving. Well, this is the gift God gave me. And I guess I'm going to write a check, put it in the offering plate, or I'm going to write a check to so-and-so who's going through a tough time, but we're all going through a tough time. Here you go. You see how that all falls apart? You see how it all falls apart? You have to have a motive for this gift. And what is that motive? It's love, isn't it? It's love. God loves a cheerful giver. Amen? That's what He would say to the gift giver. God loves you to be cheerful. Now, it's like, well, I don't feel it. A gift given in love is felt and appreciated more than a gift given out of obligation. Would you want a gift given to you because someone says, well, I guess I got to give it to you? No, of course not. You want someone who says, it is my honor and privilege to be able to help you in this time of need. Now, for me, the gift of prophecy, right, is that I'm to speak the truth in love. Amen. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 15 exhorts us to speak the truth in love. But I don't know about you. This is another essential part of the church. I don't know about you, but I sure like feeling loved. I need to be loved, don't you? You need to be loved. Now, where is that going to take place? Is it going to be taking place out there in the world? I don't think so. If you're a friend of the world, you're no friend of His. It has to take place in the church. Now, how is the world going to know? How is the world going to know that we are His disciples? What does the Scripture tell us? By the way we love one another. Can I encourage you? This is the whole point. I'm not telling you to be a part of the church because, well, you got to be here because I'm here. That's not the way it is. That's not the way it is at all. I need you here so I can give my gift to you. You need me here so I can give my gift to you, but I need you here so that you can give your gift to me. You have to have an outlet. You have to. And that's why we have Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25. It says, "Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting, encouraging one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching." Can you imagine if the church was all present? If we were all here and everyone was using their gift and it was complimentary to each person, you would have a body that would be functioning, wouldn't you? You would have every function. You would have no lack in the church. Everyone would be here. Every gift would be expressed. My nose would get itched. Amen. The Bible is held. Amen. All these things happen when the body is present. But if a member is missing, it's just like if you cut off my leg, or if you cut off my arm, or if you cut off my nose. It hinders the function of the church. So can I encourage you to be a part of the church? Not just, you need to be a part of it, but we need you here. We need each other. You'll never get to a point in life where you can say, "I don't need the church. I'm an eye. I don't need anything. I can see everything just fine. We just look through that scripture and we know that to be true. Where would the body be? Where's the rest of the body? You have to have it all. So we have the horizontal need, right? We need each other, right? But I want you to know that there's a vertical involved here. Your relationship with your Heavenly Father. Again, you cannot be spiritually what you ought to be if you're not a part of His church. Now, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 21 tells us this: unto Him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. This is where it's supposed to take place. This is where it all happens. This is where the world looks on us and says, those are the disciples of Christ because they love one another. Now let's think about this, okay? Let's say, okay, Brother Heath, you convinced me. I want to be a part of the church. What does it take to be a part of the church? Look back at the definition. You have to be a believer. You have to be baptized. Now, baptism doesn't save you. Baptism is that part where there's the calling out. Do you remember we talked about being called out? We are a called out assembly. Is that when you are baptized, you are identifying that you're with Christ and He's with me. And you're identifying with that body of believers. Because that is the testimony to the world that I am not of this world. I am a part of His church now. You know, the Jewish people don't have a problem with Jesus. Really. The Jewish people would go through and say, you know, like a young daughter or a young man would say, I'm considering Christianity. I'm looking in the teachings of Christ. They won't have a problem with it. But the moment they came back and said, I've been baptized, that's when the Jewish family held their funeral. Why? Because they had identified with a body. They have identified with something. Because you can have the thought in your mind all day long, I'm a Christian, but the expression of that comes out in the church. That's why we do baptism. Is that that's the expression that I am. It's in the water, right? That's what baptism is. It shows that we are crucified with Christ, we were buried with Christ, and we've been raised to walk a new life. And where is that new life to be expressed? In the church. But let's say you're here. I dare not make the assumption and teach about the church and not give you Christ. Maybe you're here and you're lost. And what lost basically means, if you were to die this morning, you wouldn't know where you'd end up. You wouldn't know if you'd go to heaven or if you would go to hell. That's what it means to be lost. And can I ask you, if you were to die this morning, do you know with absolute assurance, 100%, you just know it? When you died, you'd go to heaven. Scripture says you can know. 1 John 5, verse 13. These things were written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know you have eternal life, and that you would continue to believe on the name of the Son of God. So, how do we know? How does this all take place? Repentance, right? Repentance is a change of mind. And you hear me say that a whole lot. Because here's the thing, you remember when you were a sinner, those of you who have been in church for a while, you remember when you were before Christ, the BC, how that you were infatuated, that you were in love with the sin, amen? We were in love with our sin, and what repentance is the sin that you once loved, you'll now hate, and the God you once hated, you'll now love. That's what repentance looks like. The sin you once loved, you'll now hate. And the God you once hated, you'll now love. We are a witness, aren't we, of His goodness. You are a witness of His goodness. Knowing it is by His goodness, He is leading you to repentance. You are aware that in His goodness, He has spared you from being destroyed. Don't turn Him away. Don't mistake in His mercy for you getting away with it. That's not the case at all. And in fact, Romans chapter 2, verse 15 tells us that, do you not realize that you are treasuring up wrath against the day of wrath? You know, the sun rises and the sun sets, and you say, I got away with it one more day. There's a day coming when that day of wrath is going to come, and it's all going to come all at once. And the God who's dammed back his wrath, that one day that dam's going to break, and it's going to wash away all the wicked in the land. Today he will have mercy, though. Today he gives forgiveness. And today is the acceptable time. Behold, today is the day of salvation. Forgiveness and mercy have already been prepared for those who will call on his name. Would you hear the invitation? Would you hear it? Revelation chapter 22, verse 17 tells us what? And the Spirit and the bride say, come. Let him that is thirst, or here, say, come. Let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. You want to know what everything leads to? Why at the end of the service everything leads to an invitation? Because I believe that Christ is pursuing every last one of us in here. Lost or saved, he's pursuing you. And do you not hear the invitation? Come. Follow me. Do you not hear the invitation of the church? Come. Be a part. Express the gifts that God has given you in salvation. But can I say this, and let's just go ahead and we'll close with this. I'm going to ask our musicians as they'll come and we'll prepare for our invitation. Can I tell you this? A lot of people, the reason that they don't respond is that they have fear of what people think. Let me tell you something. If you had gone 3 days without water, and you're pretty thirsty, and I had the only cup in the room of water, what would you do? You would barrel down that aisle and take that cup, wouldn't you? Do you not realize in our spiritual, if you're lost here, how thirsty you are? How much you need Him? That's why I invite you. Let Him that thirst, let Him come. If you need to join, if you've been saved and you've been baptized and you need to join this church and go to work in the Lord's church and express those gifts that God's given you, I want to give you that invitation. I want to give you that opportunity. Or you're here, you've been saved, but you've not been baptized. You've not expressed the Lord's death, burial, and resurrection to the world. That is the expression of the inward transaction that's taken place. And until you do that, you are still walking in disobedience with Him. And God will not give you any further revelation of what He wants you to do in your life until you take care of the things He's already revealed to you. And what's that? Be baptized. For those of you who are lost, you need to be saved. Those of you who have been saved, you need to be baptized. For those of you who have been saved and baptized, but you're looking for a church, you need to join His church. Whether that's here or somewhere else, I want you to be walking in obedience more than anything. As we stand and as we prepare for our invitation, whatever the Spirit of God has laid upon your heart, I pray that you would respond without any hesitation, without any fear. Let Him have His way here in the service.
Hymn 397.
There's a great day coming, a great day coming. There's a great day coming by and by. When the saints and the sinners shall be parted right and left. Are you ready for that day to come? Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready for the judgment day? Are you ready? Are you ready for the judgment day? There's a bright day coming, a bright day coming. There's a bright day coming by and by. But its brightness shall only come to them that love the Lord. Are you ready for that day to come? Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready for the judgment day? Are you ready? Are you ready for for the judgment day.